cocktail. So far, you're in for a treat. Treat today. Dr. Lake is currently the associate director of bands at Potsdam in New York, and he has degrees, DMA from UNCG, two masters from Boston and the University of Maryland, and I forgot, where's undergrad?
The University of Maryland College Park, God's greatest university.
That's right.
Absolutely, and jazz piano.
So William is wonderful, and I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to him.
Awesome. Well, I'll share my screen here for our conversation. So it's great to spend some time with you all. I am really excited to share some thoughts. I'm just moving panes so I can see everyone. To share some thoughts with you all in the area of score study. I've seen awesome pictures that you all have put up of things that you all have worked on. In this last semester, was teaching conducting two and an independent conducting class. And this thought came to me of just new ways to think about interpretation and score study, like what does it really mean? So I came up with this awesome lecture. At least I think it's awesome, and hopefully you'll be able to get something a lot from it, and it will generate some good conversation together. So Dr. Edie was supposed to give you all some homework before today's session. And that was for you all to watch the movie, The Sixth Sense. Did you all do that? No? Yes? No? Danny? Danny's like,
I've seen it before, but I don't have.
Okay. You've seen it before? Okay, cool. No problem. Well, if you've seen it before, and if you remember it, you'll be able to easily see where the connections are as we go into our discussion together. So I've got a little quick clip that we're going to watch. It's about 5 minutes, but it's really, really awesome and kicks off our conversation. Actually, first, I'll go back here. So this opening graphic that I have here, can anyone tell me, when do we see this in the movie, The Sixth Sense? Is this coming up clear for you all? Can you all clearly see what's up here? Is it fuzzy? It's good? Okay, cool. Anyone remember, when do we see this? What is the image of? Anyone? You all can leave yourselves unmuted so we can make it more like a conversation. So the image is clearly a
light bulb.
Yeah, a light bulb. Does anyone remember when we see this in the movie, The Sixth Sense? Dr. Edie even saw it last night. So this is the first image that you see in the movie. Literally after the title slide, and they show, you know, all of the big names of people that you're going to see. This is the first thing that we see when the wife of the therapist is walking down in the cellar to go get a bottle of wine to celebrate the therapist's award. So literally, this is the first thing that we see. So here goes a question. One thing with The Sixth Sense, as you've watched the movie, you realize that there's a lot of things that mean something more than what we're actually seeing. The Sixth Sense actually was one of the movies that really made the plot twist a really big thing in movies. And I would argue that no movie after it has had a more impactful and intense plot twist unlike The Sixth Sense. So my question is, yes, it's a light bulb. We know the light bulb is in the cellar, but what does the light bulb actually represent?
The beginning of awareness.
Ah, the beginning of awareness. Okay. That's good. Any thoughts, Dave?
Maybe like the fading life. It seems pretty dim.
Yeah. So I just stopped it. So the light bulb is actually, it slowly illuminates to like 100%. So it's going from complete darkness to light. So, but what you're right, you know, but even thinking about it in the other sense, you talked about life. So death to life or life to death, you know, going back to the darkness. That's really, really good. I'm going to play a quick clip for you all. Hopefully you'll be able to hear this. So although you've watched the movie, I've watched the movie like 10 times. There's things that I still pick up every time that we call it in the movie world, little Easter eggs, where it's kind of like there's little hints for the audience, but you don't really pick them up as you are watching. And it's something that I think the directors love to play with us as we go back and go, oh my God, we were tipped off by this, but we didn't even realize. So we're just gonna watch this quick clip together.
How often do we see and yet not truly see?
I see dead people. They don't know they're dead.
If The Sixth Sense and its twist ending are any indication, it occurs more often than we think.
How often do you see them?
All the time.
You failed me!
Even in this final reveal, there's a meaning that most people still miss. Hi, I'm Matt, and this is Logos Made Flesh. Here's how it works. After Dr. Malcolm Crowe is shot by a former child patient, he spends the rest of the film trying to redeem himself by helping a young Cole Seer, who shows many of the symptoms that plagued his former patient.
What am I thinking now?
I don't know what you're thinking now.
Cole is at first wary of Malcolm, and Malcolm uncertain of himself. But over the course of the film, Malcolm builds a relationship with Cole, until Cole at last halfway through the film confesses that he's afraid because he can see dead people.
Walking around like regular people. They don't see each other. They only see what they want to see.
Malcolm comes to believe Cole and in the end teaches him to see this ability not as a curse, but a gift.
What do you think they want?
Just help.
That's right. That's what I think too. They just want help, even the scary ones. And I think I might know a way to make them go away.
How?
Listen to them.
It's for you. She wanted to tell you something.
The real bombshell, however, occurs in the closing scene of the film when Malcolm, along with the audience, realizes that he's one of the dead who sought his patient's help.
I see.
Cole wasn't just speaking to Malcolm, he's talking about Malcolm.
They don't know they're dead.
And in this eye-opening moment, the film quickly recaps a number of scenes in which we now see how each was wrongly perceived. Although it appears Malcolm has spoken to others in the film, in reality no one has spoken to him since his shooting except the young boy. M. Night has left scenes ambiguous, allowing us to mistakenly grasp their significance until the film's end. That's why blindness and sight, darkness and light, linked with death and life, are the Sixth Sense main motifs. For instance, we remember how the film ends, but forget how it begins with the slow turning on of a light bulb. A metaphor of the revelation to come. And it's only when Malcolm sees and realizes he's dead that he's ushered into the light, the afterlife. But it's Cole who has the gift of sight, and the film turns on what he can see. A sight which is in part symbolized by the large glasses he wears when Malcolm first meets him.
Noticed your eyeglasses, they don't have any lenses in them.
But his name Cole Seer is just as symbolic. Seer may be spelled S-E-A-R, but it's also pronounced Seer, and it's no coincidence that it's Malcolm he sees. Cole is in the middle of Malcolm's name, and pronouncing Cole with a soft C, we see that it too is a play on words. Cole Seer is a soul seer. He sees Malcolm's soul, his hidden inward being. The Sixth Sense is about seeing beyond outward appearances to the hidden reality that lies beneath, which leads us to the twist we still miss. Who else doesn't see that Malcolm is dead?
I see people.
We, the audience.
They don't know they're dead.
How often do you see them?
All the time.
We only see what we want to see, and in our blindness, we're just as dead as Malcolm. Before Christopher Nolan was known for making meta-cinematic movies, like Inception, where the movie is about the movies and the hidden messages filmmakers speak through them.
It's for you.
M. Night gave us this movie, The Sixth Sense, in which he showed the disparity that often exists between the surface of a film and its true significance. Here, the peeling back of a facade opens a father's eyes to his own heartbreaking reality.
Time for lunch, Kira.
And at the same time graciously raises his other daughter from that same death.
I'm feeling much better. That's so great, honey.
I see people. They don't know they're dead.
The question is, what else have we missed? Hey, thanks for watching. If you want to see more eye-opening videos like this, go ahead and hit.
So I'm hoping that your minds are kind of like, oh my God, like we didn't even realize many of those things that are hidden even within the movie as we watch them. And for me, when it comes to doing score study, I feel like music offers the same type of mystery for us. That often when we look at a score, we're able to discern the theoretical elements of it, the harmony, the melody, and all these things, but oftentimes we miss exactly what they mean. So I've come up with this idea that there are six senses of score study. I'll try to get all these on the frame real quick. And can everyone see that really well? Just also hello to the people who just came in the room. Nice seeing you all. So we've got six senses of score study. For me, I identify them as context. Can someone maybe give an idea about what context is? What does that mean specifically when it comes to music? I think Danny, you just unmuted yourself.
So are you talking about the context in which the piece was written? So maybe social context, political climate, things like that, that nature. If it's programmatic, what the composer was trying to portray, stuff like that. Is that what we're?
Yeah, you're right on it. Any other additional thoughts of what context could include?
You can look at the historical context on it. What was going on when the composer wrote the music? Day, age, time, feel, all that good stuff.
Yeah, because again, we conceive art within a linear space of time, right? You can't dissect it from the influences that all of us are experiencing whenever the piece is created or even when it's even performed. So as Deshaun was saying, happy birthday, Deshaun, by the way, as Deshaun was saying, you know, who the composer is, where they were living, what their backgrounds are, maybe what are some of the other pieces that they wrote, what's going on with the people and the place. It's the who, the what, the when, the where, the why. All those things are really important, okay? So thinking about the sixth sense, the reason why this movie is so awesome and the plot twist works at the end is we see so much of the movie out of context. Right? Like if we knew that the therapist, Malcolm, was dead, the entire movie would be kind of boring, right? But they save the context. Like what happens is, if you've seen the movie, he gets shot from one of his previous clients, and then it goes black, and then it comes up and it's 3 months later, and we see Malcolm walking around. So part of the context has been removed for us. And so as we're trying to make these associations, we are totally thrown off because we're missing the question to whether or not Malcolm survived the accident at the beginning of the movie, right? Okay, so tempo, rhythm, meter, I think that's straightforward. We know what that is, but what do those things tell us about a piece? So we know tempo is, you know, how fast, rhythm, we know how to discern what that is, meter, whether it's how the beats are actually grouped together. But what does that tell us about a piece of music? What does it provide for us? Deshaun, I think you're muted.
I was saying it provides you with a guide, like a roadmap on how fast or how slow to try to get it into the context of what the music is. So it's just basically here's your guideline.
Gotcha. Absolutely correct. Danny, you were about to throw an alley-oop.
Yeah, I think a lot about rhythm and meter and tempo in terms of like pulse and life to the music. Okay. Because there are so many rhythms that we understand what the music is just based on the rhythm. Like Joy to the World, we can tap that rhythm on a wall and everybody knows it's Joy to the World outside of melody and harmony. So it's the life of the piece. It's the heartbeat.
Danny, let's go with that. So does someone have like a metronome on, or is it something?
Oh, that's my fan.
Like, sorry. Oh, okay. It's like, Danny, Joy to the World. So Joy to the World, you said, you know, the rhythm is something that's discernible. Yeah, we all know that. We all know the quarter, dotted 8/16, quarter. Like, we know that's Joy to the World, right? That's part of the, almost the blueprint of the piece. But Danny, if I didn't know the tune and I just heard the rhythm, could I discern certain motions from the rhythm itself?
You can.
Well, so talk to me about it.
So I think it has a lot to do with the implied melodic and harmonic language that exists within rhythm. So as speeds increase in terms of value or the diminution of values of rhythm, you would assume mm-hmm. that things are going somewhere. And mm-hmm. then context of music theory, most rhythms or most melodies descend down to a tonic. So as things are speeding up, you're thinking, okay, well, we probably started higher and then we're moving down to a tonic. And then, you know, the fact that it's eight notes, what has mm-hmm. eight notes in it, a major scale, including the octave. So.
Gotcha. So there's something about, I think you're totally right. But for me, going with what you said, something about the dotted 8/16 rhythm makes it joyous. It just skips along, right? Dee, da, 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 beat, dee. You know, it just has a skip in there that I think does something to the emotive quality that links to the joy that the song is personifying, right? Okay, what about melody? What's melody?
The main ideas of the piece.
Okay, the main idea of the piece. What else does melody give us?
Pitch center, mold, all those things. It sets the basis for harmonic structure.
Okay, so what else do, like, for instance, if I have a melody that's in a minor key, for instance, what does that set us up for?
Set us up for timbre as well as what's the emotion.
Right, absolutely. Now, what's interesting is that I could probably put melody and harmony together to being the exact same thing, because melodies are birthed out of harmony. Even when we haven't conceived of harmony, the melody is not separate from it, but we separate it in order to talk about what is, you know, the distinguishable theme to the supporting structure, right? So as soon as I have a melody, I'm immediately thinking possible implied harmonies, right? Going back to Danny's Joy to the World analogy, because it descends a diatonic major scale, we know automatically, like, we can conceive, even if I were thinking different harmonies, is I'm going to end up with something that's someone's FaceTiming me. Okay. Even as we have the descending scale, it's supported by major quality harmonies, right? And then we talked about major minor. That's the fourth kind of area. When we think about orchestration and timbre, what does that mean? What are we analyzing at that point?
The instruments being used and the sounds that are being created by them working together.
So are there different affects that are generated by changing those colors, Dave?
Oh, definitely. Like having string instruments as opposed to mm-hmm. Wind band versions of pieces like transcriptions. Mm-hmm. You can try to make it sound the same, but the timbre is technically different.
Right. Or I would say, like, if you have a section of music where all of a sudden it becomes a brass choir is the dominant texture, that's going to do something versus the woodwinds playing together as a choir. Or if it's a solo instrument, there's something unique about hearing, you know, flute and oboe together versus flute and clarinet together versus flute and English horn and clarinet together. And all of those are specific decisions made by composers. They're not by accident, right? They are completely, you know, well thought out decisions in order to create something musical that goes along with an emotion or an affect. Absolutely. Number six, form. What's form?
It's how we get to our resolution, how we get to the journey.
Right. It's how the different parts of the piece work together as a whole, right? When we think about a story, we think about there's the introduction, right? And then we move that the characters, after they're introduced, it develops, right? And we get this kind of rising action, if you remember from elementary school or middle school when you learn those things. Then there's the climax, the oh crap moment happens, and then there's the denouement, like how the story then evolves and they all live happily ever after, right? So going back to the sixth sense, part of what's missing for us is that the climax actually kind of occurs, as far as the action, occurs at the beginning, but doesn't have meaning until the end. So it throws off this whole normal sequence of events. And because we're seeing all these things out of context, we don't know how to put these things that we're watching and the experiences that the characters are having. There's a story, but it's not the real story, okay? So here goes a challenge for all of us. I would like for us to take the six senses that we have here and put them in order of importance, okay? So if context over here is one, tempo is two, three is melody, harmony, form is five, orchestration is six. If you can put your choice of hierarchy in the chat, but don't push enter, okay? So just put whether it's like 1, 3, 2, 4, 5, 6 or 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, just go ahead and make your decision, put it in the chat, and I'm gonna sing the theme from Jeopardy. And when we get to the end, everyone has to push the enter sign, okay? Do, 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 do. Had to do a little octave displacement there. It was getting out of range. All right. So if everyone can push enter. Okay. So I just want to be clear. You all used the order of the colors, right? Or did you use the order of the numbers in the box? Which one did you all do?
I did numbers in the box.
I also did numbers in the box.
Yep. Numbers in the box.
Okay, cool. I just want to make sure it's right. Yeah. All right, so let's see. I'm going to go with, let's see, who do I kind of pick apart? let's see. All of you all, the majority of you all chose to put tempo, rhythm, and meter as the most important thing for us to evaluate when it comes to a piece of music. Does anyone want to offer, Brother Edie has just put his elections in. So you all went with tempo, rhythm, and meter. Can anyone support your answer? We're going to maybe have a little debate. I'll maybe put all of you all against Brother Edie and I. This will be fun. Go for it. Go ahead.
So I actually had this conversation with some of my percussionists this year. Mm-hmm. We're in a sectional and we were talking about something and they were like, Mr. Glover, why are you always so insistent upon rhythm? And like, if we're using the metronome, it's got to be right in time. And so we talked about church, and like you can go to church and everybody sings, and it's a lot easier for people to sing the melody together. It's a lot easier for that to come together than the simple act of clapping on 2 and 4. And when you think about how much precision it takes to line up everybody in the same thing, if the band's not clean and precise, it doesn't matter how good you sound. It doesn't matter how balanced it is. If it's muddy and messy, I don't want to hear it.
I agree with that. I totally agree with that. A question I have for you, Danny, is how do you know that the rhythms are supposed to line up and be extremely precise? Like, what tells you that? Like, what decided that?
So I'm a big believer in pocket. So it's not necessarily vertical alignment, but groove alignment.
But what's the groove?
So the groove is created through the pocket, which exists from the tempo and the rhythm and the meter.
Can the groove and pocket change?
Yes, they can
change. So explain what those changes are for me.
So let's see an example. So you can go from a shuffle feel to a straight feel, and they both have groove, and the groove is different. But your approach to the rhythm, changes.
So you said the approach to the rhythm changes.
Yes.
And that approach changes based on what?
Based on the groove and where the music lives,
right,
where it makes you want to tap your toe.
Right. But you said that there's a groove. You said there's a shuffle, there's a straight, you know, head. It could be a bossa nova. It could be a American march. It could be a waltz. It could be a ballad of sorts, right? And I'm describing, if for each of these things I'm describing, what's changing here? Like in all of those, could go through that list. Go ahead, Deshaun.
I was about to say, you're describing the context, so that should be number one. It's the context of what the base of the tempo, rhythm, meter, everything. So it's really done by context, and you're absolutely correct.
So Danny, it's not that what you said was...
Would you put style in context?
Is not style something that provides a context?
Okay, because... I could also see the argument being made that the style is created by the tempo, meter, and rhythm.
I see what you're saying. It's a little chicken versus the egg as far as the terminology. But I think what happens is thinking about it, as soon as you say a certain word, you end up with a whole list of assumptions, right? So as soon as I say American march, what tempo is it? More than likely.
20.
Right. As soon as I say American march, what's the style of articulation?
A little heavy. Heavy on the front.
Okay. A little heavy?
Bass.
Yeah. And our musical word for that would be in Italian? Marcato. You're totally right. Marcato, right? If I say a waltz, what's the meter?
3.
Unless it's, you know, Prokofiev messing with us and it's in 5, right? If I say it's a ballad, what's the tempo?
Slowish.
So it's not going to be quarter note equals 120? No, it's not. No, it's not. If I say the piece is a requiem, is it going to be in major or minor in majority?
Minor.
Right. So I think that it's impossible to look at any piece of music without considering the context first. That includes who the composer is, the what, the when, the why, the how, the what time period, what is it's all of the things that often we have to do research for. Dr. Edie, what are you thinking?
I'm agreeing with you, because it goes back to the Joy to the World. How, you know, if we knew the story of Joy to the World as someone losing their parent during the Christmas time, we would approach it a different way.
Absolutely. It would come out completely different. Or, you know, one thing I used to do with my music appreciation class is I would play Mary Had a Little Lamb. Mary Had a Little Lamb is in a major key, right? Well, if I kill the lamb and make, you know, lamb chops out of it, and I play it in a minor key, immediately, you know this tune, you know this melody, but something has changed, and you immediately start thinking, what's going on with this story? Like, something's wrong with Mary, and her lamb is not, it's not working out well, right? And what I would do is then at the last chord, I would change from the minor mode, and then I would just stick a major tonic triad and say, but the story doesn't end there, resurrection power, like the lamb is back. So immediately you're able to associate things with the context, and I'm sort of maybe giving a hint of what my number two option would be. So looking here at what you all have put, I see Tyler and David for their second one had, David and Deshaun, your second one you had harmony. Would you like to maybe explain that, David, as the second?
I think my second one was melody and harmony, kind of like second and third. I have them pretty equal in my mind. Based on what you said, yeah, like harmony kind of gives us like moods and feelings. So after you've established context of what this piece could be, and you put in the moods and feelings in it, and it kind of points us towards a path, and then however you decide to like change that can evoke different things in the audience.
I think you're totally right. And
with resurrection power is kind of throwing us for a loop, but like that's the power of harmony.
Right. And the melody, I just want to keep underlining this, because a lot of times we think that melodies exist and then we add the harmony, and that may be how it happens compositionally. But as soon as you begin to write something that's melodic, there's a function within the notes together that's linked from implied harmony. So to speed the conversation up, so we can get through all the awesomeness, I agree. Harmony comes next, okay? And then melody. Happens here. Okay. Now, here goes a question. What goes next? Anyone wanna, we've kind of deviated from maybe many of the answers that are here so far. So what do we think? Anyone could just talk. Yeah, David?
Yeah, if we're going, like after we've established context and we know that harmony and melody can kind of like build us towards paths, like those paths like kind of fit together and create the form of the piece.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe form.
Here goes just a question.
Sure.
Could we think about form before we look at the melody? I mean, at the harmony and the melody, is that possible?
I'm sure you could think about music and score city in lots of different ways.
But yeah. I guess my question is, and this is just part of the awesomeness of the exercise: does form go forth? Or can it go higher up on the priority kind of totem pole?
I think it can go higher up if we're saying context is one, then context can inform you about what the form is going to be. And then that form is further expounded when you look at the harmony and melody and figure out how those elements delineate the sections of the form.
For instance, the 12 you know, the 12-bar blues, right? That's a form, and we automatically know what harmony to expect if we identify the form first. If we're talking about sonata allegro form, right, where we have introduction, exposition, development, recapitulation, right? If we are able to discern that, does that not also lead us down to maybe some ideas of what harmonies we would maybe experience along the way? Is that possible?
I feel like you could get more experimental with the harmonies and melodies within a form. Like you can set a form, like a lot of dance styles and sonatas and stuff have forms that are kind of set based on the context. Like that's why context is pretty high up there. But then once you set context in a form with something as important as like a dance style or classical music forms like sonata, but like within that form, you can experiment with your melody and harmony more than you would if you tried to list harmony and melody first.
Right. So like thinking theme and variations, right? Like that's, you know, we automatically are set up to imagine things. And then the, like what Dave is saying, the harmony can change and the melody can be embellished. So I would want us to maybe consider, and it really maybe it becomes just how explicit the form actually is. It may be harder to do this, especially with, you know, contemporary music that doesn't use a form, or if it's thoroughly composed, that really there's no really, it's just, it starts and it ends. That this may be a way to conceive this, is see if you can delineate form first, right? And then harmony and melody, connecting it back to the sixth sense or thinking about a story. Part of the issue that we have interpreting the movie is the fact that the form of the movie is totally thrown off, right? It's like we see this tragic situation where the therapist dies, right? Is shot. We're immediately shot 3 months ahead of time. Even though the time is going forward, it's all a lie because we didn't get all of the information of the form of the story. It's because we're viewing it from the idea of it's a story we don't know. So we don't know what to expect, and what the director is able to do, or the writer of the actual movie is able to do, is play around with our emotions and the fact that we are going through this blindly for a story that we don't necessarily know how to conceive. I'm hoping that makes sense with connecting it back to that. Where do we go next? Anyone? So we've got one or two options. Is it more important for us to discern the orchestration, or how does tempo, rhythm, and meter fit into all of it at that point?
I think at this point, it's more important to discern the tempo, rhythm, and meter, because that's going to have the greatest impact more so than the orchestration and the timbre.
I think you're totally right when it comes to that. Granted, as soon as we think about form and maybe context, we maybe are already thinking about tempo and meter. But to me, when it comes to analyzing a piece, that like the actual rhythms on the page don't really matter, because like what Danny said, the vertical alignment, you just want it to all be the same. Now, granted, it's going to be influenced by form and context, but that's further down on as far as understanding and getting inside of a piece. That leaves orchestration to be the last here, how the actual color is used. Now, although we have a ranking here, what I'm not saying is if I know the context, I know the piece, or if I know the form, I know the piece, or if I know the harmony, I know the piece. No, you have to know all of these in equal strength in order to truly, what we would say, know a piece in order to create an interpretation, and then to inspire your ensemble, then to exploit this. Like, what are we going to do? How are we going to bring the notes to life? And so if I look at, let's say, harmony and melody by itself, but if I negate form and context, then what Danny said, the approach to the articulation and what we're doing is moving from objective ideas to subjective ideas. Yeah, it's soft, but how soft? It's short, but how short? It's weighted, but how much weight? It's tenuto, but how much tenuto? It's expressive, but how much, like, how expressive is it? Those are the questions that our ensembles need from us answered in our study. So how many of you all know David Holsinger's On a Hymn Song of Philip Bliss? It's the tune, It Is Well. If there's anyone else who doesn't know it, it's a piece that you definitely want to experience. So basically, if I can anyone give us maybe the backstory of the piece of On a Hymn Song of Philip Bliss, if you know it? Or if not, I've got a clip. I wrote a song about it. Like, to hear it, here it goes, to give it to us. Anyone? Does anyone know the tune? What is the tune from?
Yeah, the tune is based off of It Is Well With My Soul, which is a hymn. Briefly, the hymn was written by someone who experienced great loss. He lost everything in Chicago Fire and lost his children because they were moving across the sea to England. And he received a telegram from his wife saying, I alone survived. And he penned It Is Well With My Soul as he crossed the point where his children died. David Holsinger wrote this as an homage to Philip Bliss, who was a hymnologist. And I'll stop there.
Absolutely. Great. Thank you. That was, is it Davaron? Davaron?
Davaron.
Davaron. That would have been my third choice. Sorry, I apologize. But you're absolutely right. And so if I know that a piece of music is a hymn tune, the most important thing for me to do is to know, as what was provided for us, the backstory, which gives us what? What's one of the elements of our sixth senses? That gives us what? The backstory gave us?
Context.
Context. That's important, right? So is this a happy song? Nah, bruh, it's not. it's not, okay? It's got a lot of life. It doesn't mean that it's hopeless. It may have hope, but it's definitely not it's not Joy to the World, as Danny provided for us earlier, okay? All right, so what I've done is I've put up here the lyrics, okay? That's something that you would have to research in order to have context. But wait, you know, Lake, this is a band piece. We don't sing the words. Why do we need to know the words for a band piece? Because the piece started out as a vocal work, and you cannot separate the tune from the message of the story. It's impossible. You know, the person who drafted the tune was thinking about these lyrics first. So you got to go to whatever the first point source, whatever the piece, wherever it existed in primary form. That's really, really, really important, okay? So looking at the lyrics will reveal a lot. So there's four verses. I'll just, you know, you can read them as you're watching here. I'll give you a couple seconds just to get an idea of the poetry. And as you read, if you could just shout out some words that would maybe give us various affects for the piece. It's different emotions. No wrong answers. And you can just unmute and go for it. What are some of the adjectives or affects you would give for this text?
Trials.
Mm-hmm.
Ebb and flow.
Mm-hmm.
Peace.
Mm-hmm.
Contentment.
That's a good one.
This is more of a phrase. The trump shall resound.
Okay. So there's triumph.
Pang.
Was that pain?
Pang.
Okay. Uh-huh. How are the verses? So the verses I've put in bold, the refrain, of course, would happen after each of the verses, right? So already, this is in what form? how would we describe the form of this piece? What would we expect?
Strophic.
Okay, awesome. Okay, and so looking at the text itself, so we've got, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. How are those verses put together? If we could attach like some sort of form within the verses, what do we get? So like the first two lines versus the second two lines, how do they compare or contrast?
Well, in the first stanza, the first two lines are mirrored in the second line in terms of rhyme. And then in the second stanza, it's lines 2 and 4 that you get the rhyme in.
So Danny, what about also the emotion? So like when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, versus whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Like how does the text itself contrast with the emotion that the writer is presenting to us?
That's where I got contentment from. So like, okay, no matter what's going on, so the first one is a little darker than the second one. The second pair of lines is saying that, you know, whatever is, whatever it may be, I'm choosing to be happy.
Right. And it happens over again, right? Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. So it's gory, but like we know that because it's in the Christian context, that the idea of Christ's suffering is actually triumphant, right? And so even in that, you get this sort of parallelism where like, this really should be pretty dark, but actually it is actually pretty light. There's this kind of hopefulness and triumph that's there. I'm not going to talk more about these verses because I'll just go into worship because this is one of my top ones. All right. So how else can we then fuel our context? So I've got this hymn, band directors. I've got this hymn. I've got this text. I see how it's put together. I know it's basically in strophic kind of hymn song form, verse, refrain. This whole idea of it is well comes back. So what would be my next stop to building context?
Hearing choral versions of it.
Go hear choral versions of it, right? Like, don't just slap on the North Texas recording of this piece. Go straight, like, go to the text. And I said that because Jack is in the room. Like, go straight to, if it existed as a choral piece, go to the place where the music first existed, right? Because if I go to listen to a choral piece, or if I sing it myself, how about that? I can go to a piano and play it and sing it myself. What is established in doing that?
Well, if you go to a piano and sing it yourself, you're already establishing some phrasing. You're establishing some sort of interpretation because you've got to make decisions about the pacing and how you're going to phrase each line, what you're going to do. And then if you go to the recording of choral groups doing it, then you're getting that sort of interpretation that's totally different than how us band people would phrase something.
And not that we are incapable of phrasing this correctly if we didn't have the words, but my God, having the words and thinking from it from a vocal textual standpoint, especially because that is the source material for this piece, you can't separate the two in the process, okay? So I'm not going to play versions, but I went and found multiple versions of the same choral work, right? So it's not just one. Fuel your tech. Oh, someone said they want to hear one? Is that what someone said? Yeah, we do. Jack, you want to? Okay, so you've got two options. Do we want Morgan State University in there, it as well as arranged by Nathan Carter, or do we want the Nashville kind of CCM singers did one as well? Do we have votes? I see someone wants number one. Jack wants number one. Okay, so we're going to do number one. Here we go.
No. Rec room.
Thank you. So, yeah, so this is Morgan State University. This is the late Dr. Nathan Carter, who was their famed choir director. This is Morgan State is in Baltimore, Maryland, and this is with the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra in Meyerhoff Symphony Hall there. So connecting with building context, I would say when you have the opportunity to fill your tank with experiences with a piece, find tons of recordings of different choirs singing this, right? You're going to want to put multiple recordings kind of in your think tank as far as possibility. Now, and I do want to underline that I'm not saying go find 100 recordings of On a Hymn Sung of Philip Bliss. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying fill your context with, in this specific case, since it is a hymn, we can go find multiple versions of It Is Well As It's Been Set. And each one is going to reveal something a little different to us and our just thoughts of possible interpretation. I want to think about, for instance, if you are, you know, maybe you didn't grow up, maybe you're not Christian. Maybe you didn't grow up in a church that sang this hymn at all. You've got to fill your tank with something so you know, at least within the realm of, okay, this is what's done. This is kind of how this exists. And then try to take some things from those experiences. When it comes to a piece of music, me personally, I may listen to three respected recordings. I'll listen to them once and then never listen to them ever again, because I don't want to just replicate what someone else has done. I want to actually create in the process, because I believe that I personally have something to say about the music that I study and experience, and my ensemble has something unique to say with those experiences as well. Does anyone have any questions? We've talked about a lot of things, and I haven't really given time for any questions so far. Or we're cooking. Everybody is with what we got going on. I keep going. Okay. So if you have not heard On a Hymn Sung of Philip Bliss, I'm just going to play a little bit just to give us a context before we actually look at the score. So yes, I would suggest watching or listening to the actual piece if you are able to do that, if that's a joy that you're going to be able to experience. Now, if you're premiering a work, which is absolutely exciting and horrifying all at the same time, you don't have this to put inside of your tank of possibilities. But by all means, it's if you have it, use it. There's no excuse not to. So this happens to be the Southeastern University Wind Ensemble. It was one of the groups that I had. And I'm just gonna play just a little bit of this at the opening, and then we'll get started just to give us a context of what this piece, how it's actually presented through David Holsinger's eyes.
Thank you.
wish I could have faded out a little bit better, but it's just a little, it's clunky to get back in there. So that just gives us maybe a context of the piece itself. Just a little sidebar. Yes, they performed it unconducted. Yes, all of the interpretive things that you hear, the ensemble made those decisions themselves. I literally just sat on the podium, and just when things went crazy or things got off track, I would just stop them and say, what did you hear? What do you think? I gave each of the members of the ensemble the score. So they actually saw all of the things and made all of those decisions. And I think what I hear in this recording over many professional recordings is I hear so much different contrast of colors and different lines, where because everybody is working together to ensure that we exploit the unique intricacies of all of the colors and all the lines that's there. So you can do it. It's messy, it's daring, it's scary as crap. It's a slow process, but you can do it. If you have any questions about that process, I'll hopefully leave some time for us to do that at the end. I highly encourage it, because basically it turns the entire large ensemble into chamber music, as what it should be. And it's very liberating for the ensemble not to have a conductor swatting at flies in front of them. Exposes their rhythmic issues, internal subdivision issues, and it forces the ensemble to listen in ways that they won't listen with somebody in front kind of being traffic cop. So can everyone see this? Is this large enough on your screens that you can actually see the notes? No? Is that a no, Jack?
Yeah. It's only part of the score, correct?
Yeah, well, it's only the woodwinds playing at the beginning here. Right. So yeah, it's just the top, yeah. There's a chat message here. Thanks, Brother Connor. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. play babies. They are. I almost teared up a little bit. So almost, but it was an eyelash. So first things first. So we have our context established. We've talked about that. Let's now talk about harmony. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to kind of show you, I'm going to lead you to give me the information to reveal about this piece. And I'm going to show you how I mark it in my score. So you're actually going to see what my score study would look like, what my marks are, and hopefully illuminate something with you. And I'm going to ask questions. Like, so if you tell me something that's theoretical, something I can see, I'm going to ask you, what does it mean and how should it be interpreted? And that's something that I ask myself with every single note that's on the page. I see something, I say, I see this. And then I ask myself, why does this exist and what does it mean? It may mean that I need to ask myself also, why did the composer choose this and not something else? Those are really important questions to ask because it helps us get inside of the composer's mind, and then it connects with what you believe and what you interpret about the music, and then how it would then be performed. Because I am a firm believer that music notation, if we play what we see on the page, it would actually sound horrible. That it comes short with truly giving the essence of what music really is. And we know this, right? That we can have, if to be churchy, we can have an old church mother sing Amazing Grace in a way that would bring you to tears, that some young whippersnapper that graduated from the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, you know, it's just like, nah, that's not it. We would take the untrained but yet very impassioned version over, you know, maybe the trained kind of disconnected from the meaning and context of the piece. So if we can look here at the first four bars, if you all can look at the first four bars, my question is going to be, which is first on our list, I know we should look at form, but I just can't show it to you. I'll tell you that the way that this piece is put together, there's the introduction, then there's a verse, and then we get the introduction with a chord change, and then the verse comes again with the chorus, and then the introduction ends the piece in sort of a variation that kind of then fades into the end. So I've done that work for you pretty quickly. So can you give me the harmonic analysis for these first four bars? And I'll give you all some time. Okay. And I know I said really quickly, so at least the first, we'll give me, what's the first harmony that we have here? Did I cover up some stuff? Yeah. Anyone can shout out. First chord of the piece.
It's just the D flat major. Just
yeah. Back. Gotcha. So what I do, to me, it's not important to have Roman numeral analysis, because if I'm on the podium, I don't want to have to think, oh God, what key am I in? Where am I? You know, what's going on? All of that. So you know what I do is I literally write the chords as if I'm playing a jazz piece. You know, I just say it's a D flat chord. Because I immediately know what notes I'm supposed to hear, what notes I'm not supposed to hear. If I happen to hear an A major because the trombone player is playing in second position instead of third, then I know, nah, bruh. And my ears will tell me that's the problem, right? Instead of, oh God, this is Roman number one. This is the key of D flat. So that's D flat. That's too many steps, right? So for me is I go ahead and put the chords in and I write it literally like this. In the score. So in my score, I will actually write that D flat major that's there. Okay. What's the next chord? Anybody?
E flat minor.
Okay. E flat minor. I agree. Okay. The third chord.
F minor.
I agree. You all are making Danny do all the work. F minor. Uh-huh.
E flat major.
What was that? Say it again.
C flat major.
Did someone say B flat or what?
G flat?
G flat major. Okay. I gotcha. Okay. Absolutely. All right. So I agree with that. Absolutely. So the bass line is basically just moving up diatonically using triads, right? In the D flat major scale, right? So looking at this, where is the melody, right? So we have identified the harmony, right? Okay. Now, the melody, where is it? And how does it work? Anybody can shout out.
So the melody is on 1, 2, and 3. In each measure is what I see, and he embellishes it with neighbor notes.
Okay. So you're saying 1, 2, and 3, clarify, what do you mean by that?
The note on beat one is the first note of the melody, and then you've got some neighbor motion, so the lower neighbor, and then you get the second note of the melody on beat two, and then you get an upper neighbor, and then beat three is the third note of the melody. For me, I see him just harping on it as well in this intro.
So you're saying, can you see this little red dot?
Yes.
See the little red dot? So you've got this note, you're saying, where is the melody? Is it this?
Oh,
is that what you're saying? Or I
see it in the eighth notes. So
in the eighth notes. Okay. Yeah. Let's do it in the clarinet, for instance. Okay. Starting here on what would be concert F right here. Right. So you're saying the melody is here and then it goes where, where's the next note of the melody really?
F.
Or so it's F and then F again. Right. So like this to this or this to. Which one?
1 to 2. 1 to 2. So
this one to this, this one?
Yes.
Okay. That's a thought. Anybody else have any thoughts?
I kind of see the parts kind of intertwining a little bit to make the melody, like a composite melody a little bit. So I think it's
starts. Talk to me. Talk to, yeah, go ahead.
It starts in clarinet one. with their
sustained pitch here.
Yeah, uh-huh. And then it moves to clarinet two with their half note.
So it goes from, so this is the melody to this?
Mm-hmm. And then it just kind of like goes back and forth a little bit.
So it's going from the concert A flat here to the concert F. That's the melody?
That's what I think. Just
no, I just want to make sure I understand. Is that that's what you're saying?
Uh-huh.
Because what you started saying versus it kind of, I felt like it changed somewhere. Any other thoughts?
Okay.
Brother Connor's giving me the squint eyes of like,
No, I agree. And I think I see what Tyler is saying is that if you look like in the second and third clarinet, I kind of look at it, making a comparison to basketball is you got an assist from one person to the next, from the second clarinet, third clarinet to the first clarinet, you know, which is intertwining the melody from the lower, you know, the lower voices up to the next voice.
So I guess my question, Brother Charles, is, and the reason why I call him Brother Charles is a member of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. Just putting that out there. So is the melody the half notes or is it the eighth notes? Because I think Tyler was saying it's the half notes.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's the eighth notes to me. I think it's the eighth notes to me.
So the ba da 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 da
da da da. Yes.
So that's one idea altogether.
Yeah, and then the counter melody would be the half notes.
Ah, so we've got multiple things going on here, right? Mm-hmm. So if I take if I think about the bass and I think about the clarinet line here, right? If I think about those two, what do I want? I want to draw an arrow. So like basically, we get, there's this that's here, right? And then we end up here. Then we end up here, right? And then we end up here. And then that then pairs with what we see in the, let's see, in the, what do I want? Like going from clarinet, there's like this pairing that ends up going on where it's from like clarinet to these notes here in the bass, right? Because they're moving up by parallel tenths, right? So you get ba-da, ba-da, right? So it's thirds displaced by an octave, right? So that's at one level. Then what Brother Connor brings out, there's the compositional technique is called dovetailing. When you have one line that's shared between two different parts that are actually the same. So what I totally agree with that. So what I would do is in my actual score, we need to see that. Like that's really important. There's a conversation happening between two different parts. If I'm playing first clarinet and I'm playing second clarinet, think about your students. They're not listening and figuring out how these parts relate. They're just, it's gonna be a conversation. Well, it's gonna be a statement and a statement versus a conversation that fits together and works together. So I actually, in my score, would do this. Wait, I don't like how that looks. Undo, I would do, this is how I actually put it in my score. I draw a line that goes here. I draw a line that then would go here. I draw a line that goes like this. Sorry, this may not be completely perfect. And then I turn it into an arrow. Because what that's telling me is there's multiple lines here that make up one composite melody. And so in my conducting, so I again, I'm going like this quickly goes from what I see to what does this mean? Like I see that this melody is shared between two parts. Now the question is how do they relate to each other? The ba da 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 da. Then you have be da da da. How do they fit together? That's a question I have for you all. How do these different parts, how do they fit together? Yes, it's a conversation. I totally agree. But to what effect? Like, how do these two voices fit together?
The first clarinet part is more so a link conducting the harmonic structure and the melodic structure.
So say that again, say that one more time.
The first clarinet part and the first alto part is really a link connecting the melodic structure, which is in the second and third clarinet part and second alto part, to the harmonic structure, which is in the lower voices, like the barytax, bass clarinet, bassoon, and
right. So I'm just trying to get my, for some reason, my cursor is stuck. Okay, here we go. So it's actually doubled, right? It's the exact same thing. It's just, it's the orchestration doubles it and puts it with clarinets as well as with altos, right? So I think I'm just gonna, put the same marking here, right? Because it happens in the second alto part that then goes up and then continues here, same fashion, right? So we get it in both the clarinets as well as the alto saxes. But let's go deeper. How do these conversations, so I think you said, I can't remember, I couldn't see who was talking. You said something about the first part of this related to the second. Are they the same or are they different, and how do they differ?
Well, no, the first alto and first clarinet, that motive links the harmonic structure with the main melodic motive. Like the da yes. da 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 da, and then you take over the first alto and clarinet, take it over and pass it off to the next chord.
But how do they pass it off? So you're using objective words, but my question is subjectively, what do I need to hear? Like, yes, I agree, it passes it off, but go deeper. So what in music we can only do but so many things, right? We can make things longer, shorter, right? Louder or softer. Faster or slower, right? That's all we have. So how do I personify what you're talking about musically here in this back and forth that you're talking about? Like, how do I make it sound like it's connecting?
I'm sorry. Go ahead. Oh,
I was going to say, I think a way to accomplish that is and the composer is hinting at it with the crescendo that he marks under there. But if you let the phrase intensify as those lines pass off, so that they're leading into each other, that I think that will help facilitate the pass off.
Okay, great. I totally agree. But here goes the fault that most conductors, young conductors, have when it comes to this level of the process. What you said is totally right, but be more specific. Be brutally, subjectively specific. So, Danny, what's the starting dynamic? What's supposed to happen, and where do I end up? Do you get what I'm saying? Like, be that specific to personify what we've talked about. Like, we have this big overarching idea, but my question is how does it manifest itself orally?
So we're going to start at piano.
Okay, so you're good with the first piano? Okay, good.
And then what? That is crescendoing and we'll say that lower voice line ends at a piano plus.
Okay, and where does it crescendo all the way to here? Does it stop here? What happens? Like, where does it crescendo to?
It's kind of like a crescendo and then a smaller crescendo, because the half note is going to crescendo as well, but we want the more of the crescendo to happen in the upper voice that's falling to link back to the eighth notes.
Okay, so there's a crescendo here, right? And you called this you called this piano plus, is what you called it. All right, come on. Come on. I want to get to the piano plus. Wait. Okay, here we go. So piano plus, right? And then you started talking about the second line. You wanted it to do what?
It's called crescendo to a mezzo piano.
So it crescendos. Does it start crescendoing immediately at the half note?
Yes, but it's a paced crescendo. That mirrors what's happening in the lower voice.
Okay. So then you said paced. What do you mean by paced crescendo? I like it.
So they should be felt in the crescendo, but not heard until they jump up to that E flat. Gotcha,
but be more specific. What needs to change? What's not correct?
Their dynamic.
What should the dynamic be?
Pianissimo.
Ah.
Or even a piano minus.
Okay, or a piano minus. I like pianissimo. I like to go for extremes, right? Because if you can always add more salt, but you can't ever take it away when you cook a meal, right? It doesn't work that way. So this is a big moment here that I want to just underline for everyone. We just said that David Holsinger does not know the dynamics that he wants for the beginning of this piece, and what he put here was wrong. And that's totally right. That's big. Like, never feels as though that any composer has made like surefire dynamic, like this is what this is supposed to be. Because if the first clarinet part, think timbre now, think about how low the clarinet two is playing. That's really, really low in the Shalimo register, right? So really, you might even tell your clarinets, because of the timbre, maybe this needs to be mezzo piano so you actually can hear it and you're getting the right quality of air that's being used. You tell the first clarinets, play it even softer. So although you're saying like mezzo piano, oh my God, that's too loud. Well, no, it's not. If they're playing low F, think about how da, 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 that's in that cello kind of range, right? To really bring that to the foreground. So what we've done now is we've changed the dynamic, which I totally agree with. Danny said that we could still have them do a crescendo here, right? And they crescendo all the way to when, Danny, you said?
So they're going to end up crescendoing all the way to the second measure.
Ah, okay.
But they're starting softer.
Okay. Now, here goes a question, Danny. You said that the second clarinet part, what happens with that half note there?
It should...
Does it just keep going?
It should intensify as well. So there's some crescendo that happens there, but it's more of a supporting role and more color at that point when they get to the half note than importance.
Okay. I think that's an option. And Danny, you would be totally right. So when it comes to interpretation, there's no wrong answers. I think there sometimes are better ones, right? And so I'm going to do something I don't like doing. I'm going to say, okay, Danny, you're right, but what's another option? Because I don't want Danny to feel like he wasn't right. Because Danny, you're totally right. What's another option that maybe would exploit something else in this first bar? Personally, I disagree with the second clarinet part continuing to crescendo on the half note, because it actually reaches it. This line reaches a point of stasis, right? It was active with eighth notes. Da, 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 ba. If I were to sing that, da, 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 it could push me forward, right? But could something be said of maybe doing this with this line that sonically then is going to highlight this pass off here? And what it does is that it gets this voice out of the way. So the melody starts here, goes up here, and then this voice trails off to the background. It removes itself because it's no longer melodic ideas. This is just an idea. Now, do I agree with what Danny's saying, that it should still move us forward? So then that's a subjective decision. So my question then is, why do we make this statement? And Shellman or Drew has something that I really like how he explains this. And he put this in the chat. He said, going back to the lyrics, it mirrors the dark lines followed by the lighter lines. Like, we get this like kind of, it's this and then it's this. But visually also, what else have we created? In Nathan Carter's arrangement of this, he does it this kind of, there's this motoric energy. What is the scene that's being set? Where is this, what are we hearing? It's not eighth notes, that's wrong. We're not hearing eighth notes, we're hearing something else. It's water, it's the sea,
right? I was gonna say ocean, yeah.
That's what it is. These aren't eighth notes, these are waves, right? And the question then becomes, this is where it gets deep, this is what it gets, goes back to the sixth sense. Are we talking about the waves of actual water on the ocean, or are we talking about the waves of human emotion in grief? That's on a whole nother level, right? Because if you've lost someone like that's close to you, you have great days of joy remembering them, and then something random can happen and it's a day of sorrow, right? And that's what we see in the text. And so if we did not have that context to add to what we were making these decisions here, we actually were already doing it before we talked about what this was. But that then, that changes everything, right? Because then you get this, the idea of the waves of da 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 ba be da. Like there's these waves that are crashing over each other. And this introduction here is setting this scene of whether it's us on, we actually are the author going past this point where this tragedy happened, but it also mirrors what happens like internally with this person speaking. You get all these different levels, right? And then that then becomes the emotion that you try to embody as a conductor to your ensemble so that way it connects. Like, yeah, you tell them this is what this is about, but it's your job to show them in your gesture then what that looks like, which is going to be more than just, here goes the piece, one, two, three, four, one. That's not it. You have to show them in your conducting the waves musically, right, that are coming from an emotional place inside. So that's where the emotion of the line comes from. It comes from connecting all of those things. So conducting is a outward personification of my inward intent. So I'm literally trying to become the waves on the seashore. I'm literally trying to become the person who had this experience. It's acting. For me, before I even come on stage for a piece like this, I literally, it's like I try to become like an actor possessed with this character. And if it means that I need to think about how I felt losing both my mom and dad, both of my parents are deceased, I literally allow myself to go to that place to become my version of myself in that moment, which is dangerous. It's extremely vulnerable, right? But how can you do this piece without that connection?
So I guess my question is, we talked about how we change the dynamic because of what this is modeling. But if the composer doesn't tell you that, how do you know if the composer's thinking that?
Composers are always wrong. They don't know what they want. They don't. And Danny, as because we're not taught that way, right? Because when it comes time to MPA or large ensemble festival, it's like, this is what the composer has, and you are to execute everything that's on this page. But this was my strategy. I wanted to make the judges in the back of the room look up and hear something that they'd never thought about. And to sell it in such a way that they realize, yep, it has to be this way. Right? So when I come up with my interpretation, every other interpretation, I don't care if it's Eugene Corporon, Mallory Thompson, I don't care if it's Gabriel and Michael, it's wrong. It's wrong. That's not how the piece goes. And it's a hill that I die on, and I am committed to selling that decision. That's music.
So I guess my question is, someone who's younger in the profession, when did you get to that place personally and professionally?
I decided that I realized that my previous notion was that the composer was more of a musician than I was. And then I said, no, that's not right. Like, no, I know music and I know how this is really supposed to go. And you know what you start doing? You start playing around with these options so that way you can eventually hear how you can change things and what does it say. So Danny, your idea versus Charles's idea versus Jack's idea versus my idea versus my student's idea, it is an idea. If to be kind of preachy, it's not one of those situations where, you know, I am the way, the truth, and the light. No, there's multiple ways to get to this. And I'd rather hear your version of this story than hearing some false replication that you don't really take ownership because it's not you. So Danny, when take risks, just take a risk. Now, take informed risks, right? Because you can go outside the box. Like, yeah, you've got, let's talk about potato salad. You know, we all have our favorite person who makes potato salad, right? These ingredients, you know, you gotta have your potatoes, you gotta have, you know, the egg diced up, the relish, really nice. Some people put onions, some people put whatever in it. Yeah, and we're like, yep, this is all good, this is all fine. But then Karen shows up and she adds raisins, right? And we're like, nah, girl, like, no. Like, you just, no. Karen, you have gone too far with this potato salad. You know what I mean? Like, that's exactly what it is. You have a license. You can add all kinds of stuff. You can add some paprika on the top to give it some color. You know, people do that. Maybe some green spring onions. That's fine. But them raisins? Like, that's on a whole nother, that's on a whole. So, Danny, you've got to take risks. And unfortunately, here goes my hill that I die on. And part of the reason why I was hell-bent on becoming a college band director is it's hard to think outside of those boxes and take those risks because of just the way our festival kind of assessment kind of works, where we feel like that the that this composer and the music is more of a musician, a greater musician in the room than we are. But I promise you, before I left public school, I began to do this and it made the judges look up. And so they stopped dinging me for intonation and they stopped dinging me for all of these objective things. And then they start really paying attention to the subjective things that I've done. Like, oh, wow, that was nice. Like they totally missed that, like that shit was out of, I'm sorry, that stuff was out of tune. But instead it's like, oh, you took a risk and you made music and I like it. So my goal was to make the judges go from this to go. And then by the time they look down, we're 4 pages, baby. You got to catch up. Like, yeah, we got you. Like, yeah, and keep on going and give me my one, like, if that really matters. But like that was my strategy. It was to make the judges look up from the page. And you can't do that if all you're going to do, I know, like going in, though, Jack and I would be like, oh, on a hymn song of Philip Bliss, Jesus, it's in the key of D flat. Lord, the trombones don't know where D flat is. They don't know where G flat is either because it's going to be out of tune. Where the hell is position number like flat 4-ish something, whatever that is, 5-ish for that G flat. Lord, oh God, that horn solo, it's going to sound a mess. My God. But if you make music, then it throws all of that bias away. And I'm like, ooh, okay. Like, and so literally, even when it goes down here into my decisions, I'm gonna make a decision about this bass line. Like it's going up the scale, right? D flat, E flat, F, G flat. Here goes the question. There's a crescendo mark, but do I believe in that? And I do, because rising tension of the scale rises in tension, right? And then I hate to just skip to this because I want to get to more of your questions if you have it. In measure 4, I'm going to add a retard. It needs to slow down. The music must slow down there. But then the question becomes, how much? We have these eighth note motoric energy, and then it naturally slows down, like rhythmically. That's where rhythm, because we get this da 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 da. We've been dealing with eighth notes, and then all of a sudden we get ba da da da. So it's naturally going to sound like it's slowing down. So the question is, yes, a retard, but how much? Can it become too much? I would say yes. We're only in the fourth bar of the piece. Does it need to grind to a screeching halt? No, because it's going to do it again. So those are the subjective questions that you need to ask yourself. But one thing I wanted to just illuminate for everyone. We started this talk around like maybe 12:30-ish, right? And we have only analyzed the first measure of this piece. My question to you is, how deep have you gone when it comes to subjective interpretation with music that you do? And if not, you're cheating yourself, you're cheating your students of really getting true musicianship beyond what we see. What we see is not enough. Music notation is not enough. It does not quantify or qualify really what we want to hear musically. I'm a Matrix fan. And for people who just do what's on the page and try to execute, you know, I've done every single crescendo as here, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I say that's taking the blue pill. The red pill that, you know, in the movie, it says like how deep the rabbit hole goes. How deep down this rabbit hole can you go to reveal something about the music that's uniquely you that when I hear it, I go, yep, Lawrence. Damn, that's how it has to go. That's my goal. And so literally, I mean, it's a long process. I totally believe that for every minute of music, there's 3 hours, if not more, of score study. Because I'm making these decisions. And so how does this, what's the next step? Because I've made such finite decisions, when I get in front of my ensemble, this conversation between clarinet one and clarinet two, I begin to show what that's supposed to be. And so it's not about time. I'm actually reminding the ensemble, or I'm trying to get them to do all of these little subjective little nuances, like a little DJ, like more of this. Oh, no, too much. No, more, a little bit less, you know, et cetera, like that's what I'm trying to do. Or, oh wait, no, don't break the line. Like that's conducting. It's not about this. That the students can play by themselves. Like that's what you heard in the recording that I showed of my ensemble. They didn't need me. Now, granted, did many times, did it crash and burn? Absolutely. But I believe as a conductor, time is not my job. When I do honor bands, the first thing I tell the ensemble is, listen, time is not my job. That's your job. And if it's gonna crash and burn, it's gonna crash and burn. Now, I may move in time. I'm always moving in time, but I'm not showing you time. And of course, you know, it causes people to go, you know, if something's sustained, you're gonna see just this from me. And sometimes the kids are like, well, what beat? Keep counting, keep swimming. Like that's it. I'm showing you where this is going. But I can only do this at a subjective, detailed level if I've made these type of decisions along the way. Because other than that, what are you really saying to the ensemble? So I think we need to go into question, and I knew that I would only get maybe through one measure. There's so much more, even in that first measure, to parse out, and even in these first four bars that we can go into. But yeah, let's maybe questions, Jack? Yeah, okay.
Do you go measure by measure? Or do you do do you do the whole piece on one of the senses of, like, do you go through and do all harmony, analyze the harmony of the whole piece? Or do you say, I'm going to do all six senses and measure one, and then I'm going to do all six and measure two? Or is it some sort of hybrid?
It's a hybrid, because if the idea comes to me, I want to lock it in and go. You know what I mean? And so I would say the harmonic analysis, the context definitely happens first. Complete context. Then the harmony, I typically do probably like in like 8 bars at a time. Like, so I do the harmony, like, so I kind of maybe find the phrase, if I can quickly find where the phrase ends, I figure out the harmony, and then I go through all of those steps through those. But score study is not a finite process. It doesn't end. Now, you want to be able to hopefully share everything that you know subjectively in the first rehearsal. Don't waste the student's time, right? But as you hear, you're going to keep refining these things as you experience it, right? So literally, I'm doing score study and thinking about things about the score until I walk out on stage for the performance. That's when it stops. And then usually after performance, I listen and I go, darn it, I missed 50% more things. And I think, well, I'll get another chance at it whenever I get to do the piece again. So score study is never finished. It's always finishing more so. Yeah, good question. Any others?
Yeah, I got a quick question. With pieces that have, I guess, a lot of similarity, have you noticed, I guess, over time or your experience that you're able to kind of maybe take an idea like from this piece and to translate it, you know, to a next one, maybe seamlessly or, of course, with some variations?
Oh, yeah. The process becomes, I think, faster. I'm probably when I'm like 65. I'll finally figure it out. But what happens is you're always taking other things and applying it. So like I go through this experience. Yeah. I'm going to apply something that I know, you know, these were my thoughts about this. Let's see if it works in this situation as well. So you are borrowing things, but I still am going to put it in writing on the score. I am a very big, it's a hill that I die on, that literally, like, when my conducting students, if you didn't mark it and if you get up and your score is not sufficiently marked, I just tell you to sit down and give you a zero, because I just believe that you have to show your work, right? And you have to remember what you've told the ensemble from rehearsal to rehearsal. Where do you put that? You got to put it in your score for the notes. So I think it gets faster, but man, it's not fast, and it takes a lot, because I will think about a measure forever before I am sold on how it's supposed to go. I'll sing it, then I'll go to the piano and try to play it. Then I'll go, yeah, it's not right. And then I'll say, okay, this is how it goes. Get in rehearsal here the first time and tell everyone, I don't like it. It's supposed to be like, try this. So it's never a final kind of thing. I have a very clear idea of what I want it to be. And it's very, very clear and very subjective, just like this. But it changes all the time. And sometimes the students do something that I didn't think about, and I'm like, yeah, let's do that.
So it'd be like maybe preparing Thanksgiving dinner, but for a different family.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. That's a good analogy. I like that. But what you're seeing is I put all of this information in my score. Like, I mean, my scores are marked up like this. So that way I have something that's fueling what I'm saying gesturally. You see conductors where you're just like, damn, my goal is that from piece to piece, you could mute my recording and still hear the music specifically and know exactly where we are in the music. That's my goal. So, yeah. Dr. Edie?
No, I was saying, are there any other questions for the good Dr. Lee?
I know this is a lot. I apologize. I went and down the... It gets deep really quick. If you're feeling that you have not been doing enough score study, then this was successful. And what questions you're asking yourself and... just how deep you're being specific with things. Because if you're not specific, it becomes kind of gray. Like, it's like, what is that? And if you can remember the recording I played of my students, you can tell they've made a lot of decisions along the way in order to say something. You got to do the research. So yeah,
we need this clinic at Midwest, brother.
Definitely.
Seriously. Cause it's a, there's a lot of raisin and potato salad going on.
Yeah. You
know, the attendee, just being honest, this definitely gotta happen, bro.
Well, and then you have, but there's both sides of it, right? There's raisins in the potato salad, and then you got the potato salad is just dry. You like, it don't have no substance, no salt, yeah, no pepper, no seasonings, no it. So you've got both of them are issues. Not doing enough is an issue, and doing too much is also an issue. And that area in between, there's a lot that you can do. And if you think about, you know, one composer just that was always against the grain, Leonard Bernstein, like, all of his stuff is all over the place. It was just controversial. Some of it, I'm like, there's no way in hell that I ever would do it this way. But you can tell in that moment, you better not tell him that's not how it's going to go, because that's how it is. Robert Shaw was another great choral director that was like that. And you have to be willing to take risks. And it may fail. Like, don't be afraid of failing.
How do you make so many decisions and avoid the trap of saying a lot but not saying anything?
I trust the ensemble, and I trust myself that, like, although I've made a lot of decisions, the ensemble has room to make decisions as well, if that makes sense. And I try to show what matters the most out of all of these decisions in my conducting. I try not to speak much. I try to say as little English to my ensemble as possible. And it's because I believe I can actually say more with my gesture than I can with my words. But that's also, you know, after years of studying conducting, I know, you know what I mean? Like, it's so I get even the whole thing is like, well, how do I get even to the space of using gesture in this way? Use your imagination and don't be bogged down by 1, 2, 3, 4. Show the waves, show the line, and that's already hopefully going to get you out of just not connecting to the music gesturally. And that's part of the problem, is that you can do all of this, but yet if you're in front of the ensemble not showing what you've decided orally, then it negates the two and you go back to a gray performance. So that might be part two of the discussion and how we do that, Brother Edie, in person, when we can do that. But yeah. Any other questions?
Have you gotten to a point where there's a score that you just know back and forth and you know exactly which things to look and hit and say, you know what, I know this one back and forth?
This is one, I mean, all of it, like, you know, the whole first suite, I don't need a score to that. I know exactly what I want and I can dig in like pretty much immediately for all the salt, pepper, and ketchup, as I call it. And I tell my students that's what I'm going for. The salt, pepper, and ketchup, it's what makes food taste good. I know what those things are. And, you know, just because I believe something one time doesn't mean that it doesn't change from time to time, to the next time. So I even maybe make fun and say, okay, I'm doing Holst again, but maybe let me start with a fresh score and do the score study all over again and see what new things I find. So, yeah. And I love making people like go, oh, like, whoa, I've never heard it done that way before. Thank you, because it's me. But yet also say, but I also really like it, you know? So I don't want them to say, I've never heard it quite done that way before. That has a different affect to it. Wait, there's something in the chat, I think. Wait. Oh, no. Okay, it was just comments.
Brother Lake, I was thinking just in this first section right here, a great rehearsal technique, I just want to get your opinion, is taking an opportunity to duck out like one of the layers, like Evander Cook, we got a saying, a long note is a strong note. And so maybe dropping that long note out and allowing the second clarinets and even making it as individuals, one clarinet to the next clarinet, have that musical conversation to really bring out all the dynamics that we talked about, and then layering in some of those long tones a little bit later. And
yeah, no, I think that's really important. You, because the idea, your students only see one line, right? You see the score. Yeah. So you have to exploit those connections for them and I was going to say force, wrong word, facilitate and encourage them to hear that and make it happen themselves. I would suggest saying, okay, you know, second and third clarinet and first clarinet, you all, let's play together. And let's just listen. And you just sit back and just watch and see what they do on their own and what ideas they bring to the foreground about their lines. Because again, I call it being a single line player, you don't get the whole picture. And so until the ensemble truly understands your subjective ideas that's in your score study, and they understand the why, the how, they understand the context. So all of this context stuff, this isn't a secret. Like, you learn this context stuff and share it with your ensemble. They've got to know those lyrics. They've got to know the background story. You like, don't hold all of that knowledge prisoner. Like, you want to enlighten them. Think about at the Sixth Sense, the reason why we were fooled is because we didn't have the full context. That's not our goal as conductors. We want to share all the wealth of knowledge that we experience with a piece. So I think you're totally right, Charles. That's definitely the way to approach it, is get down to the bare bones and then put it, scaffold it all back together. Absolutely.
All right, any final questions? Edie's
having lunchtime.
I got a dentist appointment in a couple minutes. I'm trying to scarf it down.
Okay. Okay.
But any other questions for Dr. Lake?
So I've got one. First, I've enjoyed everything so far. Something that I've done with my kids, where after giving them, like, reading the program notes and giving them the backstory and the context, I allow them to kind of take from there and create their own story within the piece. For example, for NPA this past year, luckily we went before COVID hit. I did a piece called Syzygy, and it's about the alignment of the planets and all that. But I explained that and told them which part of the song represents that particular, what was it, Earth, Moon, and the Sun. But then I had them, had the students write their own background story to the piece, so they could, because some of them, they may not be in the science, so they may have heard it and they get it, but it doesn't really connect. So allowing them to kind of write their own story to the piece so they can get their own connection. Like, mm-hmm. Have you done that with your groups or for your thoughts?
I may not go as far as, I think it's possible, especially with pieces that don't have a programmatic context. You know, if there is no real backstory, you know, maybe I do that. But I try to, in this piece, like, there's such a unified emotive quality here. So I wouldn't want this to be like about, you know, someone that has their dog walking along the side. It's just not deep enough. You know what I mean? And so I think I would use that for pieces that don't have, you know, maybe lots of depth here. But in this piece, literally every single verse, regardless if you're a believer or not a believer, from the Christian context, there's so much as far as the affects and breaking down like what this is. So one thing that I will do, Drew, that I usually for my conducting classes, there's two verses and two choruses presented in this piece. The thing I ask my students is which verses have been arranged and presented here. There's four verses, there's only two. So what are those two verses? And I encourage them, that's a space where I tell them, well, what is this first one versus the second one? When the brass choir has this, which one is that? For me, it's the, and Lord, haste the day when my face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound. Like, to me, that's my Rocky on the top of the steps in Philadelphia moment. Like, that's what that is. But for somebody else, it may be something different. But that gets into the idea, you're almost even connecting for them how you can take one theme and say different emotions with it. You're kind of even encroaching on composition, you know, and how that can happen and how you can do that. You know, thinking about Jimi Hendrix and his legendary, you know, Star Spangled Banner performance versus the Whitney Houston version versus, you know, somebody else, like different things are being said in each one. And so I think just letting the students realize that, you know, there is a story, even if there isn't a story, and that you have to commit to that story, I think that's the bottom line takeaway. So I think your exercise is great. Absolutely. So. Any other questions?
Dr. Lake is popular.
No, it's my faculty mentor for me to be upset about that course is what it is. Because, no, you reclaiming my time. You weren't available when I told you I was available, so you're going to wait.
Yep.
So I'm not in a rush at all. So.
Well, before we go, we need to take our picture. So if everybody will come on the screen and give a nice smile. Give y'all 5 more seconds.
Jordan, Adrian. Oh, okay, here we go. Jordan's.
1, 2, 3.
Cool.
All right, that's really good. Let's everyone thank Dr. Lake for this wonderful presentation today.
Thank you. It was fun.
Thank you, sir.
It was fun.
Cool. And if you don't know JR, he is a wonderful, wonderful resource. And I'm sure I'm saying this and he'll agree, but if you need him or need something, he does not mind if you contact him.
Yeah, absolutely.
About anything. Yeah, so I'm about to go get some fillings.
So oh, that's fun.
Not